Now, Ethiopia has begun filling the reservoir of its giant hydroelectric dam upstream on the Blue Nile. Now, this is expected to help Sudan control floods in the future. But Ethiopia is yet to agree on operating terms with the downstream countries, Sudan and Egypt. The $5 billion dam has caused nearly a decade of tension in the region. The project is the centerpiece of Ethiopia's bid to become Africa's biggest power exporter and lift many of its people out of poverty. Its government says at full capacity, the dam will turn on the lights for 70 million Ethiopians who have no electricity. Egypt worries the dam could affect water levels of the Nile, which is essential for nearly 90% of its population. Well, let's speak to Alam Ahmed, who's president of the World Association for Sustainable Development. He's via Skype from London. Thank you very much for joining us on Al Jazeera. We've seen flooding in Sudan, which is coming despite Ethiopia starting to fill the Grand Renaissance Dam upstream on the Blue Nile. Do you think this will potentially make any difference with seasonal flooding events like the ones we're seeing right now in that region?
Thank you for inviting me. I don't think we have said this a couple of times, even in your respected Al Jazeera several times. The dam is not going to solve any problem of flooding in Sudan because we have to look to it as a project. The objective of that project is to keep or to have a reservoir of 74 million cubic meters. It's not about regulating flooding or anything. So I don't think, although the dam is not yet in operations, but even when it will be in operation, it's not going to stop or reduce this kind of natural incidents. More seriously, I think the dam, as we many people have said, scientific paper documentation, MIT, many people argued the danger of if this dam in the future, for any reasons, goes wrong, it's not going to be a flooding like this. It will be a total disaster and destruction in the capital of Sudan, Khartoum.
So, again, after the filling of the dam, you expect floods like the ones we're seeing right now in Sudan to continue happening?
Yes, the current one, to be absolutely clear, the current flooding in Khartoum, as the capital, which you all see, but across the whole River Nile, from Dongola, from Halfa, across the central part of Sudan, is primarily a natural disaster. No one can argue against that. And the defense, the Sudanese defense, or the bridges, or all the protection mechanism, which all engineers understand very well, they have failed to deal with it, not because of the failure in the system. I've always been a critic of the government, but in this instance, I think we have to be to give things right. The average of what this can hold in terms of water is being broken. It's a broken record. It's quite heavy. It's above the average upon which these all defense mechanism across all River Nile in Sudan, including the city Khartoum, is above the average. So engineers, when they build these kind of dams in Sudan, they build it to match with the average of flooding expected. But they do not build it with the extreme like this because you can't. It's very expensive. Right. Sudan is a poor country. That's number one. Number two, what is happening? The loss of life, which I am very sympathized with. I really, my heart and mind goes with all those lost their life down in the street. It's a total, I think it's a natural disaster, but it's a totally failure of the government to respond.
Right.
The government has been warned about this level of water is going to come. The Minister of Water, he the professor himself, scientist, he told the government a couple of weeks ago, this is what is going to happen. But on the ground now, even in Al Jazeera, you can watch all the news from Sudan. You haven't even seen any of the government presence to help people on the street.
Flooding is indeed worse than usual, and you say the government has been warned about this. This is also, I imagine, compromising access to water for people. Do you expect the situation to get worse in the coming weeks?
Absolutely, absolutely. It's already worse, and it will continue to go worse. What is people in Sudan right now affected by this flooding need? They need water to drink. They need someone to give them sacks, sand. People have made themselves human shields, like the one you have seen in the right of the capital. It is shameful, and at the same time, it shows the Sudanese resilience. But it's shameful for a government, its own people, live people, making themselves human shields. Why you have failed to deliver sacks and sands? You have to go there, give them water. They have no water. And again, one thing you need to take into account, floodings, naturally, they come with serious health issues. There will be loss of disease, loss of problem. Even now, some environmentalists are trying to help the country by giving them warning about snakes, insects, which will come out of the water. Mm-hmm. It's a very serious humanitarian crisis in Khartoum. It's a natural crisis, nothing to do with the dam, but it needs the government. Where is the Minister of Social Affairs? Right. This is the time where you see a social fabric supported by government motivation and leadership. We have never seen a single talk from any of the government officials. Prime Minister is in different ways. He doesn't feel the pain of his people. I think this is a real classic example of a government failure to support its nation. And just one example, George W. Bush lost his leadership when he failed to respond to a natural disaster in the U.S. I think what we are seeing in Sudan is a natural disaster with a clear, total government failure.
All right, thank you so much. Certainly a very dire situation for the people of Sudan. Thank you for talking to us. Alam Ahmed, President of the World Association for Sustainable Development, joining us there via Skype from London. We appreciate your time.
Thank you very much. Pleasure.